I want to preface or prelude the main content of this presentation, which is about me talking about something much bigger than any individual artist, namely the power and the glory of art. Power, aspirin P, power, paint pot, and the glory in excelsis of art. Art is that most wonderful human endeavor which all artists, regardless of their awareness, their skill, their talent, or their medium, are part of, whether they realize it or not. Art at its best transcends the mundane and lifts, elevates the human spirit. Relating to philosophy. Philosophy, think of the ancient Greeks. Philosophy meaning the love of truth. Begging the question, what's it all about? What are we doing here? What's going on? I like to think the answer to the question, what are we doing here, and so forth, can be found in an Ibsen play, for example. Try Ghosts on for size, a Turner painting, a Schumann symphony, a David Smith sculpture, or perhaps Gray's elegy written in a country churchyard, all offering us portals into man's heart, which makes our hearts go boom, boom, boom. I want to end with a quote from the aforementioned Robert Schumann. To send light into the darkness of men's hearts is the duty of the artist. And don't you forget it. Thank you. Starting with a quote by the late, highly respected British artist, Sir Eduardo Palazzi. Art is a small word which expands, i.e. there are many, many, many ways of making art. Myself, I don't paint, but I collect paint tubes, used paint tubes. I also collect and use old stretchers with these delightful stretcher keys, okay? They're like that. I'm like that woman, that stewardess at the front of the airplane, we're gonna belt the thing up, okay? The oxygen mask comes down next. Anyway, there's that. And I don't do pen and ink drawings, but I collect old India ink bottles. I don't take photographs, but I made a major, large exhibition using reject 8x10 prints in various configurations. I usually work in series, allowing me, working for my collections, allowing me to make extended artistic statements. Why do I make art? I don't know. I'm not entirely sure, but I do know and trust that my process works and that the end product works. It's taken a long time to get there, but that's I feel confident with that. Art is a very, very, very rich thing to do. Artist is a great thing to be, but the pay is not so good. How do I work the way I do? It's a sort of organic process initiated by things, objects which I collect and play with. And I get to know quite intimately. It's not true. Not true that I went to bed with a button the other week, but that's what I do. I get to know this thing in isolation, whether it's a ice cream cup like that, or whether it's a clothes peg, or whatever it might be. And I study that in detail. And then that's the beginning of the process. Then sometimes I add other materials, okay? I end with a quote by Jonathan Swift, vision is the art of seeing what is invisible to others. After art school in New York City, I freelanced as a designer, but more mostly as an illustrator. This is a Penguin book cover, Land Reform and Economic Development, using reproduction paper money, representing land, arable land. And next one is a collage that was mostly three-dimensional materials, not two-dimensional materials, and illustrating an article in More magazine. This is a book I did on acting. I did two books in New York in the early part of my career, and which was a lot of fun, and the perks were wonderful because it was the time of the business lunch in New York. Business lunch, that was about 3 hours, right? And that's part of the deal, okay? And, okay, this is a self-evident drawing of a baby grand piano. Boy, I wish I had it. Not the drawing, but the piano. A picture for Nothing's Beyond Your Reach. I still like to think that. This is for broadcasting advertisement. Okay, and that's a collage and an ink drawing, as you can see. Next is, this last one is illustration for Opera News cover of Puccini's Turandot, using pasta. What more Italian could you have than pasta, right? And it represents a sort of beginning step, you might say, way back when I started working with three-dimensional elements, which is what I primarily work with now. But that was an early step in the process. Okay, now we're gonna go to the English Seaside series. Okay, now this first piece is called Bumscape. It's actually, I just spotted it around the corner. Okay, so you can see it in person as it were around the corner. All right, now then. There's a bit of a story behind this. Okay, I met my wife in 1969 in London. At a philosophy school. We married a year later. Okay, and in 82, our family. It was difficult because the first child was due, and I wasn't making much money at that stage as a freelancer. So I became a primary school teacher in London, right? And then in 82, our family, two young boys, an infant daughter, moved to New Zealand where my parents-in-law lived, right? Now the first 2 weeks in New Zealand, we lived in a motel. And I found myself in the evenings, not playing cards, but playing with playing cards. This is an example of that's the first time I've used playing cards in making art. I've used them a lot since then. Okay, now Bumscape, that's the first one. Now this is another story that I'm gonna have to say, a backstory. This is Sweet Visions of Glory. Now, in 1966, I was awarded a Fulbright scholarship to go to London, attached to the Royal College of Art. That year, I met the English photographer, Tony Ray Jones, at CBS Records. And we both had business there. And I befriended Tony, and he suggested that when I got to London later that year, that we would flat together, which indeed we did, in a wonderful old Georgian building in Marylebone, two-story. And we'd flatted together along with about 50 other people coming and going. It was a good, rich time in London. Okay, that's a picture of yours truly. Haven't changed at all. Framed by Seaside Elements, sweetie wrappers, wonderful Meccano wheels, and it's signed by a cloud cut from a English Seaside postcard. All right, and the wheels are indicative of this monoplane, which I was quite pleased with, which goes round and around and around. How do I get off of this thing, right? Okay, the next piece, Bank Holiday. This, look, note how this is the way I work in a way. Look at the stripe, the canvas, deck chair canvas, relating to the deck chair canvas that it's framed with. All right, this is a good example of using reject photographs that I found in my friend Tony Ray Jones's wastebasket in this dark room. Okay, Road to Wigan Pier, echoes of George Orwell, obviously, 1930s. This is all the wheels. We're heading north to Wigan. We're going to Wigan. These appropriate dated advertising signs are framed with a toy tin plate, architectural toy. You see all the Meccano elements, and the whole thing suggests movement going this way. This one here, the mode of transport here is bicycles. Road to Portobello, a small town if you don't know, just east of Edinburgh, okay? Now here, the pier is festooned with bicycle adverts, okay? Pilings are represented by old, very simple, thick black graphite pencils and some water down near the sea here. And then in the background is a tin for bicycle chain. And the whole thing is framed with inner tubes. And likewise, this piece here is underneath the green pilings. Green pilings, again, pencils with raffia suggesting water and paper cutout suggesting water. And Meccano. Okay, and a lovely black frame, which you can't see too well. This last one is called Seaside Rock. So the Seaside Rock, which you're all familiar with, there, and framed with other seaside elements, sweeties, polo mints, that are really lifesavers. And the middle is a lovely photograph of a pier, what else? All right, but the interesting parts are these casings, as it were, frames, one, two, and this one here, which is a upside down L, that's a right side up L, and that was the middle of something. Anyway, they were designed, were part of neon tube signage. So we had letter forms filled with neon tubes, which lit up at night, obviously, and they were discarded, and I found them in a derelict site behind King's Cross Station in the late 1960s. All right, next series is the Piano Work Series. Okay, let's get it. All right, Piano Work Series. When in New Zealand, I was introduced to pianos, and I acquired a couple, two or three upright pianos. This is fairly obvious what's happening here. Using piano parts to make, that's an I and so forth, P-I-A, and you can all spell piano. Right, that's quite a nice piece, quite simple, but effective. This one is called Pianissimo, Pianissimo, softly, softly, using American softballs encased in the same piece repeated, the same piano piece. These pieces are all the same piece repeated from part of a piano. You can't see it, but there's this lovely old, very old Star Fox. I keep working this old stuff. Why is that? Why is that? I'll tell you what, that's not old, that's new, isn't it? So I'm not entirely an old so-and-so, right? Okay, this next piece is piano wood. This is piano components and clusters filling up the space which ordinarily be filled with lead type or display type. Now, the pre-war pianos which I had, I think there's something like 2,000 pieces in the piano. I think that's right. I forgot. However, so if you take a piano element and
which is composed of several elements. You put it in warm water and the pieces dissolve. Hence you get these wonderful collections of pieces. Now, because it's in the type box, you can see P-I-A-N-O reversed as in display type, which it is. Likewise, wood down here, piano wood. Okay, now the swastika represents horror show, we all know, okay? But it was not unique to the Nazis. It's a symbol, it's a lovely graphic symbol used by older cultures in subcontinent, Indian subcontinent, and in the American West, for instance. Now you'll see here, this is a Navajo, I think. Navajo. Anyway, it's American Indian. Yeah. Now see that? That's reversed, but it's the same basic symbol. So what the Nazis did, they're very good, I gotta say, graphically. What the Nazis did is they reversed it so that the members, as you can see, are facing the opposite direction. But it's the same symbol. Okay? Now here I've used one piece repeated to make a pattern of swastikas. There it is like that, which is a little bit difficult to see in the photograph, but it's quite nice when it's lit nicely, and it's sort of suggestive of the mindset, as you, if you will, of the Nazis. Okay, this is called Piano Blues. All right, this is what I've done here: is taken the piano, and I've substituted the black keys and the spaces made by the substitution. I filled with various blue things. Crayons, Cuisinart rods, a picture of Gainsborough's Blue Boy, right? And old paint tubes. I told you I had old paint tubes. I got a lot of them. These are all blue ones, all right? Blue paint tubes. And these are playing cards and so forth. That's what that's about. Okay, now all these are representative of exhibitions. Again, drawing from my collection, so this is just a sampling. Okay, now we're going to go into, that's a picture of the Richmond Store Gallery. Okay, the next series is ice cream packaging. All right, now, after 20 years in New Zealand, we went to Maine, USA, which is wonderful. We settled in a little town on a great river, and it was terrific, okay? And we bought an 1897. You people think you got old buildings. 1897 general store. My friend and I spent 5 years transforming the ground floor into the gallery, which turned out really well. This is half the gallery, but you can see using the freezer chest to display art, right? Using the top of this original potbelly stove. The cat came with the territory, right? And that these were shoe, so I'm using a lot of things, shoe lasts, and these are picket fence elements with discs on top from a mill, a cotton mill. And then on top of that, I arced the cell. That's an old counter and so forth and so on. And you see these petrol tins, which are indicative of the general store, which mount the lighting system. Up here are barrels, which would have had oats, barley, molasses, I don't know what, okay? Now, in the 1950s, ice cream was made locally, not far from where we live, as a product of a big dairy estate, a big farm, okay? And then nobody knew what happened. It stopped in the 1950s. Then a friend of mine was on the board of the trust that ran this. And he said, oh, they're going to dump all that stuff and get rid of it. So I perked my ears up. I drove up to the site and I collected all this wonderful ice cream material, packaging material, really terrific. And the result of this was a big exhibition. I'll just show you. The name of the company was Dave's Ice Cream, okay? And these I call these glass seeds. So the idea was that you do this to create a disc and representative of movement.
You can see what happens if you make a circle out of that. I won't labor the point. Okay, now, the title of this piece is what? Busby Barkley Blue Ice Cream Dance. Now, Busby Barkley, you may or may not know, must be a sin to be a lot more. And remember, I was a famous Broadway and Hollywood director, and more famous as a dance choreographer. And his thing, his trademark, was using chorus girls. And he made this wonderful geometric pattern using the chorus girls. Now this is, then he'd film it from the fly space of a Hollywood soundstage or a big Broadway theater, the fly space being way about up there, all right? And he'd have his camera ray up there, you know, you can imagine, right? Don't ask what kind of, anyway, he was marvelous, he's very famous. This piece, these are the girls, these four girls doing their stuff, twirling around, and the, you can see this lovely negative space and a relationship between the girls traveling more or less the same RPM, but it makes for a nice piece, and it's a sort of tribute to Busby Barkley. All right, the next piece is ice cream, is P stands for ice cream party. Okay, this time I've used ice cream wooden spoons, the same source, all right? And still in their packaging, framing, a big P made of more ice cream packaging and different elements that say party, or P for party, old posters and what have you like that, okay? This piece is called In Perspective, and it's really inspired by these wonderful ice cream cups. And again, I got lots of these for a small price. I got lots of these, they're great. And they're covered with wax, which means that they last that much longer, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, so I use those, which relates to the 620 camera black and white film, black and white cups. These are various other elements, black and white. And these, again, on a disc, which I use a lot of. All right, these are from an old mill. Okay. Now, this one is called Vanilla Manila. It's a play on words using Manila envelopes, all right, and on which is stenciled Manila, and on the top, Vanilla, stenciled on top of these, the tops of those cups, like that. So I don't know if that's clear or not. So you've got Manila. Now, Manila, the capital of the Philippines, right? So, this is appropriately framed in cigar boxes, the Philippines being, along with the Netherlands and Cuba, great cigar people, okay? This last one here is auto picnic. It's exuberance of America in the 1950s, all right? That's a picture of an Oldsmobile. 1936, take my word for it, okay? And then again, these lovely cups of vanilla things suggestive of ice cream with this, and it's movement, it's a circular base. We're moving in America. In the 1950s, President Eisenhower, initiated the interstate program of highways in response to what was going on in Europe, okay? The Soviet threat. The theory being you could get from east to west coast, get your men and material and what have you back and forth easily. Consequently, Americans and their Oldsmobiles or Chevrolets or DeSotos or whatever were able to venture forth into the wonderful new nation, you know, post-war America, a time of abundance and cheap petrol. Okay, this is this is replacing 1880 mansard roof tiles in Richmond, Maine. The town we lived in was a wonderful town, and we had some friends who lived in this is old sea captain's house. And I came by and I saw these characters, what's going on there? And my friend Pam was in the front garden doing whatever. I said, Pam, what are you doing? What's going on? She said, oh, I'm replacing the tiles, replacing these tiles, all right? There we go, like that, you see? And so you see, the exposed bit is the gray, and they overlap like that, so you can imagine.
But they're getting pretty old, 1870.
So they had replacing it with some synthetic stuff. I prefer the old thing, but anyway. So I said, Pam, gosh, what's happened to them? She said, I don't know. What was going to happen is this guy's up on the roof, we're going to flog him. Okay, so I said, can I have some? So she gave me about 20. That's not enough. So I ended up at about 300 or 400. Again, for a small price. Okay? Now, this is the Second Empire. Napoleon III, 1852, 1870. Okay? Made with one of these tiles. And that's the Second Empire, a Roman numeral II, with the king and queen. Now, they weren't royals. Napoleon III was not a royal, but he acted like one, just like it's not the right. So he acted like one. So there's a king and queen, and note the diamond shape, the same shape as the tile. Okay, the same shape. And it recurs in this big series I did on the Mansard group tiles. Again, this is a very small sampling of the era. Thank you. Okay. The Americanization of French Second Empire architecture. Okay, now America, young nation, harnessing its great industrial strength, all right, and which made for, and they were challenging this country until about 1890, they were equal in terms of GDP and so on. Anyway, they didn't have a lot of culture. America didn't have a lot of culture. So what they did, they appropriated, they sort of ate what was going on in Europe architecturally, i.e. in France particularly, and that's a Mansard roof. That was a Mansard roof you saw back there. That's a Mansard roof, okay? And you see them all over the place in New England, all right? And so this is sort of taking a bite at the French architectural tradition because there's a little bit of hunger in America, a cultural hunger. And you'll notice the 13 red and white stripes of the American flag. This is the Franco-American display. 1889, Franco-American display in Paris, and the French were quite sympathetic to the American cause and so forth. Anyway, this was using a Mansard roof tile, as you can see, with this newfangled American washing machine device, all right, which is incredible. It actually had rollers. Had rollers. Remember those? Or your grandmother might have them. You don't remember them. I do. Anyway, that's what that is. You've heard of W.C. Fields, My Little Chickadees? Ray would have heard of them. Anyway, he knows. Anyway, this is my big chickadees, made out of segments of these tiles. Okay, the next one is an example of me using lots of different materials. This is a replica of wood-fired boilers, steam boilers, on a Hudson River steamer, 1881. You think I'm kidding? I am. Anyway, I'm using teapots, admittedly, English ones, sorry about that, but they're Revere teapots, gorgeous things. I'm using Meccano again, using that wonderful spools. Matches, that's charcoal, artist charcoal, because it's a wood-fired boilers. Straws, water tube boiler, and so forth. And that worked out quite well. Okay. The next is shutterwork series. Okay. Now in New England, in Maine and New England, there was a lot of lumber. There's a lot of lumber. A lot of trees, all right, and cheap labor. So houses were big. You've just seen one. There were a lot of houses like that. And they had wooden shutters. Wooden shutters. Now, the sea captains, whether they're commercial, whether they're trading vessels or whalers, went all over shop, all over the world. Of course, Spain would have been first up or last up after the 18 months tour. This one here, this is Fandango, and if you listen carefully, you'll hear the sound of castanets. Right? Yes, you heard them, well done. Did you hear them way back there? Of course you did. Okay, this next piece, Island. Very straightforward, all shutter pieces except for the rowlock. Okay? Now, these slats represent dories, fishing dories, which are great big. If you ever see Captain's Courageous, fishing dories, okay? And
Okay, this is called Shutter Island Watercolor. Now, shutters are akin to piano parts. At first glance, they're pretty good. When you start applying a surgical procedure and some investigation, you find out how beautiful these things are. But this is a good look. I mean, this is fantastic. So that frames water made by water slats. By shutter slats. Shutter Island Watercolor. Very mysterious. Very mysterious. Do we dare row there in our dory after dark? What are we going to find there? Very mysterious. Okay? And that is a watercolor, too, for obvious reasons. Shutter Bug. You're all familiar with old-fashioned shutters. And then framing what else but a wonderful old wooden house with lots of wooden shutters. Okay? And that 620 camera element relates to this. So it's sort of the hint of what's going on. Okay, this one here is a whole shutter framing a nursery rhyme. And here you'll see matches, poker chips, and that I use a lot. Those are common materials that I use, all right? And Picasso said something about every child is born an artist, but the trouble is when they grow up, They lose it, okay? We all know about that, don't we? Okay? Next piece is more. These are actually frame stretchers and stretcher keys, but this water is indicated by shutter slats. Artist Summer Breeze, Monhegan Island, famous island in Maine. Okay. This is the last series I'm going to show you. Usually, almost always, I work in series, but these are sort of oddball, one-off pieces. This is using plastic cabriole clothes pegs and marbles to indicate a helix based on this gorgeous wooden boss base. All right, yeah, clothes pegs. Next one is, we lived in New Zealand for 20 years, as I said before. This is called Maori New Zealand. So these are pencils here, stuck into it, right angles. They're blue and black pencils around which are woven NZ, left to right and top to bottom. All right. And in New Zealand, the Maori's common colors for Maori's are black and red. These are all typewriter ribbons. Some of you remember those,
yeah.
Right? Okay, this piece is about the dairy region in New Zealand, all right, so indicated by the cows, rubber stamp cows. I didn't paint those as rubber stamps. Oh, this is called the Dutch New Zealand. Now, besides the 10-pound palms, the Dutch were going to New Zealand en masse, and we met a lot of Dutch people when they were in New Zealand, right, that had come over in the 50s, all right, and So I use these Dutch these colored cuisinaire rods, which is indicative of the Dutch, and also one of my favorite artists, Piet Mondrian. That's what that is, all right? And I use a lot of cuisinaire rods as well. One more, this is Don't Shoot the Piano Player. It's an ammunition belt with black and white frames in lieu of those awful bullets, which do awful things, all right? And suspended by a wooden disc and a piano pedal, which looks rather like a Western 1848 44 caliber. Would you agree?
Yeah, oh, sure. Yeah.
Right. And this one is a small effort or a small nod to the awfulness of the history of the black folk of African Americans. So I've used, it's called a racism, as you can see in Mississippi. So the eyes, it's stencil lettering, but the eyes I've indicated with American erasers, what you call rubbers, American erasers. And then these are mounted on a rare rabbit molasses barrel slat, okay? And this, like I say, it's just a small nod towards the awfulness that my nation is responsible for. And I think Josiah Wedgwood would approve. Because he made those medallions, you've seen them over there, right? So thank you, Josiah Wedgwood. I'm in good company, aren't I? Right? Okay, now, this is a favorite piece of mine. Nobody else likes it, but maybe not. Okay? It's a love, it's an example of one thing, of one item. This is a wonderful sort of 1890s, 1900 yellow, zinc yellow paint and tin. It's gorgeous. It weighs a ton. It's gorgeous. And then I related to that by using black and yellow, or mostly yellow balloons and black and white, suggestive of shadow. And then it rotates and you get a kind of shadow play betwixt the yellow balloons. It's a lovely piece. And they're suspended by these cages, sort of rubberized metal cages, sort of racks. And that's Massachusetts, that's New England, and pretty good. This last piece, I think it's the last piece, another beautiful tin down there. That's Edmonds, it doesn't matter, it's from New Zealand. Now, in New Zealand, they use a lot of corrugated roofs and sidings, right? So they sell brushes that are corrugated configuration, so that you, with metal wire, they're wire brushes, scrape off the old paint. So I've taken those brushes, taken the bristles off, and sliced them up, and it represents Edward dance competition, doing a foxtrot. Edward, get your shoulders straight, lad. Get your shoulders straight. This is foxtrot, strictly ballroom. Right, look at that. I was number five, I was the guy over there. But anyway, and that represents females and males. And it's quite nice because you see how that represents somebody's posterior. It blends into somebody else's posterior. It's kind of it's kind of a good piece. Again, these pieces are good if you rotate them. If you rotate them, they get nice shadow play and so forth. Okay. This is Bell's tea. This is a kind of commonplace, what we call in New Zealand, gumbo tea, what you call builder's tea. Okay, so ding dong bell, and with the crayons inside of the same colors, the crayons inside. Okay, I think that's the last one. Whoopee. Now, I meant to say earlier, I don't think I said it. I forgot to talk about it. Did I say I was talking about myself? Did it for an hour, hour and a half? It's over. Now, next we're going to have a break. Fill your wine glasses. Take a stroll. And please, please, please look at the art. Not just mine. But please look at mine. Not just mine. But this is a great repository of Stoke and Trent fine art, thanks to Amanda, all right? And Emma Jane showing it here. So there's a lot of very good stuff to look at. But do please look at my stuff, which is back there for the most part. And around the corner, sales table. Constant self-promotion, sales table, all right? Anyway, and also, if you're interested in sales, and commissions, I welcome commissions, thank you very much. There's somebody back there who wants a commission. I welcome commissions, and what I do with commissions, using your materials, right? So if George has got some great stuff in his barn, I'm your man. I'll turn it into a nice piece of art, right? And so forth. So, okay, after the break, we'll have a question answer period. So thank you for listening, and enjoy the break.
I get London to New Zealand and New Zealand to Maine.
No.
What I don't get is Maine to Tunstall.
I wonder about that myself. But we found we couldn't live it because of the expense in London. So we ended up here, which is great, because now we're in England, not London. It's a different mindset, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right? So, there was a lot of toing and froing, but... Okay, thank you for the question.
You know, there's a couple of things for me personally that stand out of your work, certainly what you've displayed to us here, the social commentary.
Yeah.
You know, through your life, through your observations,
political,
geographical, you know, we see so much of that. Have you got any work that's in progress at the moment? Or if not, what do you think will be your next piece?
Well, there's always stuff in progress because I usually work in, as I said, for a series. So there's, I mean, that piano series started in New Zealand, continued in America, and it continues now. So a lot, like a lot of series, it's never quite done. It's always an ongoing process. Like Frameworks. Frameworks started a long time ago. That's Frameworks Minor. I've got a whole series of bigger frameworks. But to answer your question, I'm working now with galvanized plates and nails to make, obviously, abstract sculpture. But, yeah, I mean, I've got a lot of worldly interest, right? And I'm interested in history, and that comes into it, right? So, yeah, does that answer your question? Okay. Otherwise, too bad.
And the other one, you know, it's... You've certainly been finding beauty in what other people may disregard for many years. You know, when we face a climate crisis, when sustainability is the topic in many households, certainly in many corporate entities, you know, everybody is fighting for sustainability. In terms of materials that you've found and that you've found another life for, is there a particular material or item, object, that has stayed with you in your memory process, the most precious that you feel, I've immortalized that?
Oh gosh, that's a tough one, because there's a variety of things that I collect, that lots of collections. So, you know, it's difficult to answer. I mean, I love Meccano. Meccano's great, you know, pre-war Meccano. And, I like pre-war everything. I'm basically pre-war, you know. So, but other than that, I don't know, you know. And it's things evolve and things occur, and one gets an object and you study it, and it opens up a whole avenue of possibilities. You know, part of that creative process, which is totally exciting. Yeah.
Okay.
She's asked two questions. Oh, we got another one. The gentleman.
Is there anything in Stoke-on-Trent that you've, as an adopted Stoker recently, that you feel is relevant that you could contribute to your art?
The only thing I knew about Stoke before I came was Gordon Banks came here, and he used to be a bit of a football fan in London. And also I knew it was the Potteries, but I didn't know what that meant. But yeah, the history of the Potteries and the people, I feel quite touched by. And I love the openness of the Stoke folk, right? This has been the exception up here, right? It's a bit posh for me up here. There are actually people with ties here. But we feel privileged to live in Stoke-on-Trent. There's a kind of spirit. Well, as you know, you're probably a Stokey yourself, it's good. And of course, the history of the Potteries is not glorious. It's pretty awful in a way, but it's absolutely fascinating.
Can I just add that we are privileged to have you in Stoke-on-Trent?
Yeah, all good. Thank you. Excellent. Yeah, any other questions? Yes, Maria.
Is there anything that you've had trouble working with, or you haven't been able to find?
That when you collect things, and people say, "Where did you get all that stuff for?" The minute you let it go, you know, you've had it 10 years, and then you find a use for it. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of stuff I'll never use, but I got an awful lot of stuff that I will use, hopefully. Yeah.
You must have a huge collection of things that have been following you around the world.
Yeah, as we had that large property, I collected a lot of stuff, right? And we're lacking used ritual sheds around here, so it's all in our tonsil home. So we had a 20-foot container and then a 30-foot container coming. And filled with stuff. So yeah, and it's my wife I'm very patient about. it's awkward. It's awkward. Not for me, but it is a lot of stuff, you're right.
Yeah.
Yes. Sir.
Can I
David?
Yes, Ed. Two comments. First of all, you're very humble. I know that you have when Stoke were vying for City of Culture, I know that you put together some pieces of work for Stoke.
Yeah, that's right.
A lot of people in this room won't know that.
Yeah.
I know it. You worked hard at it. Unfortunately, it went to Coventry or somewhere else. But I know that you do have Stoke in your heart.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
But I do have a question as well.
Yeah.
Because it sort of predates me a bit. When you were rummaging around the back of King's Cross looking for rubbish in tips, did you ever get arrested?
You mean for vagrancy?
For anything.
That's another story. No, I didn't. I was pretty fortunate. I had a friend who was I met before. He was a BBC producer, and he took me in hand and took me around London to various places, like King's Cross Station, where they're still using steam shunting locos. This is back in the late 60s, yeah. And he took me to various places, and I picked up this, that, and the other. Not a lot, but no, I never got arrested. No, not for that.
She's going to ask me a rude question. Sorry.
I haven't. I'd really love to know, and I've kind of touched on this with you before, but you know, New York City, when you were a student.
Oh.
You know, can you give a flavor of what that must have been
I'd be delighted to.
Time, please. Thank you.
Don Jose of Far Rockaway was not me. Don Jose was a great Latin lover, and he's part of the mythology of New York City and show business. Now, it was very exciting because it was the youth of that time were revolutionary. John Baez, Bob Dylan, you know. Whether you agree with their political points of view or not, there was an energy there. Young people were anti-Vietnam War, and there was, it seems to be lacking today. But if you think of Paris in the 1920s and 30s, the art capital of the world then, if you think of the Parisian skyline, I mentioned mansard roof tiles, lots of mansard roof tiles, and all like this, zigzag, and garrets, artists in garrets. In New York, it's all horizontal. It's all horizontal and vertical, i.e. rectangles, all right? But instead of garrets, we had lofts. It was loft society, where I lived in Lower East Side, what they called East Village then. And they had Tom Wazelman, his loft was not far from where I went to art school, right? And lots of lofts. Franz Klein, lots of people. And even Edward Mackenzie had a loft. Yeah, and I had it with two other friends from art school, and it was marvelous. It was the top of an old machine shop. It was marvelous till the winter time. And I was lonely. I was on my own. And my two mates went home. I said, please stay, spend the night with me, spend the night. And it was a wonderful place. But as I say, it was cold water, and the top, there's no insulation, the top story had been a machine shop. I had a potbelly stove about that big, and I had my bed there, my drawing board, and a toilet with a cold water tap. That's your lot. That's it. All right. But, and then it was, but I was saved because the landlord made wooden boxes in the ground floor and had this big cardboard like barrels filled with all the scrap wood I could have. So I just, you know, that kept me alive in the wintertime. I got a bit smelly towards the end of the week. So I got to Grand Central Station. In those days, before people did drugs big time, they had very civilized places you could have a shower for 25 cents. They gave you soap and a terry towel, yeah, you know, white thing. And it was really nice. So I go up there once a week to have a, so I'd be nice to be near, right? But no, it was an exciting time. It was an exciting time. And there's a lot of, so New York kind of took over from Paris as the art capital of the world. I think that's fair to say. And with the advent of abstract expressionism. And there was, I was never the center of much at all, but I was on the periphery and met a lot of interesting people. One guy was one of Timothy Leary's Harvard students that he was part of the LSD, initiation of LSD. And I you know, but without any credit to myself, you just meet very interesting people. And yeah, it's a great buzzy city. I mean, it's a lovely, lovely city. And they have ethnic pockets. I live near Little Italy, and right near a Ukrainian section. Yeah, no, it was good. And yeah, I had a few adventures there. Not all of which I can. Believe me. I wasn't that exciting a personality, I'm saying, but I did my best. I did my best. I mean, there's great stuff going on in New York. Yeah, question.
So, with your, where do you get your inspiration? Do you get the inspiration from the actual pieces of materials that you collect, or do you get your inspiration and write down a notebook and then look for pieces? Which way around is it?
Probably the first way around. It's a lovely question because they're just bare frameworks, and then I can relate to that in the future. Yeah. So it is exciting. Yeah.
Is it your concepts are so intricate and poetic?
Well, like I say, it's very exciting. You know, being an artist is kind of a privilege. You know, to have that talent, a God-given talent, and it's marvelous. But the pay is not so good. I could have worn my normal shabby outfit. All the holes.
Thank you, Edward.
Thank you.
A warm thanks goes to Runa as well, for being your personal assistant in the preparations for.
Thank you for being a receptive audience, and life, I like to think, it's about this. Regardless of art or engineering, whatever you like, it's about collectively coming together. That's so important, you know? And we lost a bit of that during COVID.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's very important, whether it's a one-to-one or a group like this, because in this interchange, we become one. And ultimately, there's only one of us, okay? I'm also a philosopher. I like it.
Oh, I'm going to the river, maybe by and by. Oh, I'm going to the river, babe, and there's a reason why. 'Cause the river's wet, and this season gone dry.